Today we're going to talk about collecting and testing specimens. This information can be found in Chapter 38 of your textbook. Specimens or samples are collected and tested to prevent, detect, and treat disease. Some specimens are tested at the bedside, so for instance, a patient's blood sugar, but most are tested in the laboratory. All laboratory specimens require requisition slips with identifying information and the test order. When collecting specimens, it's important to use a clean container for each specimen. Do not touch the inside of the container or the inside of the lid. Be sure to identify the person. Label the container in the person's presence. Ask the person not to have a bowel movement when collecting a urine specimen. Ask the person to void before collecting a stool sample. And do not put toilet tissue in with the specimen. There are a couple different types of urine specimens. So first is the random urine specimen, also known as a routine urine specimen. It's collected for routine urinalysis. No special measures are needed. It is not a sterile specimen. It can be collected from the bedpan, the urinal, or the hat. To collect, you identify yourself and explain the procedure. Provide for privacy, wash hands and put on gloves, assist the resident to the toilet or provide the bedpan or urinal, instruct the resident to urinate, put toilet paper in the trash for disposal, remove gloves and wash hands. Then you'll assist the resident to return to a comfortable position, put on clean gloves, pour urine in the specimen cup until half full, place the lid on the cup and label immediately. You'll then remove your gloves and wash hands, place the call bell within easy reach of the resident, and document the procedure. Next is a midstream specimen. It's also called a clean voided specimen or clean catch specimen. It's used to determine if there is a presence of bacteria in the urine. The perineal area is cleaned first to reduce the number of microbes in the urethral area. The person starts to void into the device. Then the person stops the urine stream and a sterile specimen container is placed in position. Then the person voids into the container until the specimen is obtained. Next, we have the 24-hour urine specimen. All urine voided during 24 hours is collected. To prevent microbe growth, the urine is chilled on ice or refrigerated. The person voids to start the test with an empty bladder and you discard that urine. The test must be restarted if a voiding was not saved, toilet paper was discarded into the specimen, or the specimen contains stool. Finally, we have urinary catheter specimens, and that's when a nurse inserts a catheter into the bladder and removes it after collecting the specimen. A urine specimen can be collected from a urinary catheter. The urine in the drainage bag is not used. The port on the drainage tubing is used to collect the specimen. The nurse does this. It's only allowed by CNAs in some states. For infants and children who are not toilet trained, you place a collecting bag over the urethra, and usually a child can void about 30 minutes after drinking fluids. There are a couple of different things that are tested in urine. First, you can test for pH. Urine pH measures if urine is acidic or alkaline. Changes in normal pH occur from illness, food, and drugs. Normal pH is 4.6 to 8.0. Injury and disease can cause hematuria or blood in the urine. At other times, the blood can be hidden or known as occult blood. In diabetes, the pancreas does not secrete enough insulin. The body needs insulin to use sugar for energy. If not used, sugar builds up in the blood. Some sugar appears in the urine. Glucosuria means sugar or glucose in the urine. Diabetes may cause ketones in the urine. Ketones are substances appearing in the urine from rapid breakdown of fat for energy. The body uses fat for energy when it cannot use sugar. The presence of certain white blood cells can signal a urinary tract infection, and protein in the urine can signal kidney or other diseases. A reagent strip is a test strip that has sections that change color when reacting with urine. to use, it's important not to touch the test area on the strip. Then you dip the strip into urine and compare the strip with the color chart on the bottle, as seen in the picture. In some states and agencies, testing urine with reagent strips is a routine nursing task. A stone or calculus can develop in a kidney, a ureter, or the bladder. Stones can vary in size. When stones are present, all urine is strained. Past stones are sent to the laboratory. Some stones are removed by medical or surgical procedures. Others pass through the urine. When straining urine, the person drinks 8 to 12 glasses of water per day to help pass the stone. You would expect large amounts of urine. Stools are studied for fat, microbes, worms, and blood. Melena is black, tarry stool. Occult blood is when the blood is hidden and you can't see it with the eye. It's important to make sure that urine does not contaminate a stool specimen. Ulcers, colon cancer, and hemorrhoids are common causes of bleeding. Often blood is seen if the bleeding is low in the bowels. Stool are black and tarry from bleeding in the stomach or upper GI tract. Bleeding may be in very small amounts. The stools are tested for the occult or hidden blood. So when you're testing for occult blood, the stool is smeared, like in box A, and then you smear some more stool on box B, and then the flap is closed. Then you apply a developer to boxes A and B on the backside of the test packet, and then the color changes are noted. Mucus from the respiratory system is called sputum when expelled through the mouth. Sputum is not saliva. Saliva is a thin, clear liquid produced by the salivary glands in the mouth. Respiratory disorders cause the lung, bronchi, and trachea to secrete mucus. Sputum can be tested for blood, microbes, and abnormal cells. Sputum is coughed up from the bronchi and trachea, which is sometimes hard to do. It's easier to collect sputum samples in the morning because secretions collect in the bronchi and trachea during sleep. Blood glucose testing is used for persons with diabetes. A drop of capillary blood is collected through a skin puncture. The fingertip is the most common site for skin punctures. Inspect the puncture site for trauma and skin breaks. Do not use swollen, bruised, cyanotic, scarred, or calloused sites. Such areas have poor blood flow. Use the side toward the tip of the middle finger or ring finger. Do not use the center as this site has a lot of nerve endings. In children, the third ring finger is used. In infants, the plantar surface of the heel is used. A lancet, which is a sterile disposable needle that is used to puncture the skin, is used. It's a short pointed blade that punctures but does not cut the skin. The lancet is inside a protective cover. Do not touch the blade. A drop of blood is then applied to the test strip, which is inserted into the glucometer. A glucometer is a device for measuring blood glucose. And this picture here shows a glucometer and then the test strip inserted, and then the 113 represents the patient's blood sugar.